two things I say to my students. One is if they can't hear you in the back row, they can't vote for you. So can you hear on the back tables? Am I all right? Secondly is I say to them, absolutely never use PowerPoint at lunch. Never. I am about to use PowerPoint. So the only advice I give them is walk around, look a little crazed, do anything, because it's awful at lunch to do what I'm about to do. What I have done for a number of years is to sort of just give a weather forecast after elections about where the environment is going in the country. I have tenure, so unlike weather forecasters, you can be fired. I can still be on Fox News next year or whatever it is, even when I am wrong. But it provides some insight, because what happens is when you're a leader, you often focus on things that are very, very close to you, and you miss some of the things that are just going on around. And so I try to give people a reference point to go for. And then secondly, let me just make a point. And when people grow up in the United States, they actually pay no attention to this. It turns out we have more frequent elections than any industrialized country. So my students have said to me, Bob, I don't want to hear a word about an election for the next 10 years. And I said, sorry, 23 months from tonight, 2/3 of the Congress will be up, 2/3 of state legislators, 1/3 of all governors. Many of them actually, as you'll see, a reason why they will actually face some grueling primary challenges. So rather than saying, let's get on with health care and never once think about an election, unfortunately, people who are going to be up are going to be trying to sense what the wind is. Now, I have to apologize ahead of time. If I were to appear in Nashville, they would say what Blendon says can't represent us. And I will say today, it will not represent you. And that is the picture of the United States that I like to talk about. We have huge divisions, and I can't stand any place where I actually represent the average American. There is no spot left that average people live. We have sorted ourselves out politically. We like to get up, get the newspaper in the morning, and say, I agree with you, and the neighbor says, I agree with you, and go back in. And it turns out we have a country where people do agree with each other, they just live in different places. So what I normally do is I pull together all the exit polls and all the polling data done, and I try to give some forecast of what that means. So we're going to run through this. Let's see if this works. All right, so let me see if I can just summarize this. For years, I gave these talks, and what I would talk about is what American voters just did. I can't give that talk anymore in America. It turns out knowing what American voters think as a whole is meaningless. So let me give you an example. And this is hypothetical, and then you'll actually see it turns out to be quite real. I could show you some poll, and it said 52% of people who live in Mississippi think that we should extend Medicaid coverage to people under the ACA that didn't. And I would tell you it was meaningless. Why is it meaningless? Because the governor of Mississippi is a Republican, both houses of the legislature are, and the majority of people who elected them have no interest in extending the ACA, any way or the other. So it has no predictive value. In fact, what I'll show you is the country is split, so it's like Hatfield and McCoy. You don't average their opinions. And so what really counts is who runs the county. So what I'm going to show you is at the moment, the president runs the biggest government decision. So we're going to look at his voters, and it's through his eyes. But unlike other countries, while we're talking about the president's mandate, one, we were talking about lunch, this is my problem. The other team won the House. And by the way, there are 30 Republican governors, and what I pay much more attention to is 24 Republican state legislatures with a Republican governor. So whoever elected them did not elect the president. And you'll see that in a minute. They just didn't. So when they come to the state house in the morning, they don't say, thank God we have the mandate for Obama. Let's go ahead and do it. They kind of look ahead and say, whatever the mandate was, it wasn't in our state for that. At the other end, I'll show you a moment, are people who live in states that voted for the president, voted for the Democratic side, and really have very strong feelings about wanting to move forward. Connecticut is one of them. So let me see if I can summarize the world first from the president's point of view. So what you're going to see in a second is the president's voters, bottom line, they want more government and health care. If there is a problem, they want the federal government to get right involved with state governments and do it. they actually are much more oriented to the federal government than the state government. For those of you who are suspicious of the federal government, the president's voters feel better with the federal government. Secondly, I'll show you in a minute, the country was split over the ACA, not so for the president's voters. The president's voters love the ACA. Not only that, half of them think it's some tweety dumb inadequate bill that needs to be improved for that. So the signal walking around the White House is go for it. We got it. It's over. The debate's there. Our crowd likes it. And by the way, let's add some improvements to it. Next point. In the course of the election, we actually had a very big discussion because Congressman Ryan became the vice presidential candidate, whether or not Medicare should be in a very different form in the future. A fixed amount of money would go, you would choose between private plans and Medicare. Likewise, the idea of block granting to states. Just so a few of us remember history, Bob Petrucelli and I remember when Richard Nixon actually talked about giving block grants to states too. What did Obama voters say? Hell no, I don't want anything to do with that. So as long as the people who were elected in this election have the governing authority, the idea that we're going to restructure Medicare or restructure Medicaid is off the table. That doesn't mean the amount of money you get is going to be a lot smaller, which it very well could be, but it will be smaller in the current structures of that. And I just want to say one thing, I am required. In health policy, people are very polite and they don't like to mention abortion as a major political issue in the United States. If you are in elections, abortion is an unbelievably important issue. Much more so, every place I go, well, how do they feel about the doc fix? Well, doc fix is very, very important, but in the election, the abortion was dramatically more important. And so it goes like this. If I don't want any more restrictions, I voted for President Obama. And so there's a book about to come out of Harvard Press, which says, guess what? The party who appoints the federal judge actually, over time, on the average, has policies reflecting the party it does. So my take will be very much that the appointments, the decisions, anybody here from Planned Parenthood, there will be funding of Planned Parenthood. The president's voters were overwhelming. How did you get me into this discussion? So what I want to do is show you the other side of this. Because there are 30 Republican governors, 24 legislatures, and I just caught Speaker Boehner saying, I can't do this, I can't do this. And you say to them, how could he say that? Well, I want you to share the people who voted for them. And then we can talk a little bit about this. So basically, healthcare actually was the second issue in this election, incredibly important for the president's side. Why in the last 90 days would nobody talk about it? Very simple, because everybody voted on it was a Democrat. And so the president didn't pick up a lot from other people on health care, but his core supporters really, really care about the health care issue. This is support for the ACA since it was done. And many of you believe in the ability to just get public agreement on issues. And basically what the slide shows you is that from the moment it was enacted, half the country liked it, half didn't. It got slightly better after the Supreme Court. Nobody convinced each other in 2.5 years. Many of you like running ads, millions of dollars for ads were run, everything else. At the end of the day, people weren't done. But it turns out it was not a great issue for the president. That is actually, of all the Democratic candidates running for president, the only one who passed the big health care bill was Obama. He had the least credit of anybody running for this, because when you see a bill, it becomes much more controversial to people. I'll get to this in a minute. Right, Speaker Boehner was saying we have to deal with entitlements. Let me give you an easy warning. As long as you're up here about entitlements, a lot of people shake their heads. The minute granny is getting something different under Medicare, very different set of discussion. So when you actually get down to the ground to discuss the changes, these are very difficult changes politically. So let's quickly just take a look at government health care. And students, you obviously know this, say to me, Professor Blendon, you make us study the word polarization. I don't know what polarization means. So polarization is on that slide. And you may need to put your glasses on or something like that. But one says, should government do more to solve problems? Team A says 78% yes, and Team B says no. overwhelmingly. How about less or more government regulation? Team A says, go for it. Team B says, why did you even raise the issue for that? So here is the most significant thing dealing with the expansion of Medicaid. The Supreme Court surprised all of us. Instead of wrestling mandates to the ground, that would be the great decision. At the last minute, particularly, and he's a Harvard Law graduate, I have to be very respectful of that, for that, what does he decide? He decides, well, the mandate should go, but by the way, not mandates for states to expand Medicaid. So what the slide says is that if I'm a Republican, I do not think the federal government, and these are actual voters here, should go ahead and push for any additional expansion. If I'm a Democrat, 92% want everybody expanded and covered. But if I'm in Mississippi, it's going to be different for that. So should government do something about fixing the healthcare system? We were talking about this at lunch. Basically, and then it says, which government? I only want to surface Governor Romney's voters for you to notice that 40% of them said, hell no, no government. The rest pick states. The president's voters, we're revved up, time to go. Send in the army, let's fix healthcare once and for all. So we have a split on what we should do. How about simple policy issues? And this is really important when you set up an exchange. If you ask people, do you want a competitive health system? What is in their mind? Do you want a competitive health system? Or do you want a lot more regulation? And it turns out, even for the president's crowd, people are confused. So the political, and I did this polling early on for the Massachusetts State Legislature, and what it turned out to be, I could say to them, mix and match. There's absolutely no consecutive. So the governor is freezing insurance rates on Monday, and we're talking about expanding competitive health plans on Tuesday. My friends who are economists say to me, this is a little unclear, Bob. Are you going to have competition? You have regulation. You have to understand from the voter perspective, it's a mixed thing. How about a little of each? For that, and so we're likely to see that across states. This is pretty simple. What do you want to do with the Obama health care plan? And so people say to me, all Americans agree. All Americans agree. I don't know where you come from, but 78% of Obama's voters want the bill. Just go ahead, get it done. It's over. Half of them want this thing just expanded. If you look down at the bottom, 84% of the other team want the bill repealed. So I want you to take to Mississippi. I'm a Republican governor. I am a Republican member of the legislature. What mandate do I have from my voters for that? Well, Obama's elected. You lost. But honestly, we didn't lose. We are, if they stayed here, we didn't lose. For those of you that need a little visual help, figuring out where you are, I color charted this for you. So there are about 20 states whose governors and legislators believe that they were elected not to go ahead with this bill. There are another 20 states who absolutely expect tomorrow morning exchanges to be running, uninsured to be covered, Medicaid to be there, and insurance costs to go down. And they will be incredibly disappointed in the governor. So the biggest change is California. So California is now a Republican-free state. So basically, you have 60-some votes in the legislature for that. You will see a major, major effort to try to do this. The critical issue, and so I'll go back to this at the end, the critical issue is 214. If in 214 the election is up and these states who really care are not running, it's going to lead to a situation where the opponents are going to say, "Not well, it's a good idea, but it can't work." So the critical issue is, I'm not expecting, if I was standing in Nashville, that they're talking about how they're going to make this work and they expand Medicaid and how they're going to have outreach. But if a state like Connecticut, 2 years from now, isn't running up working civic leaders supporting this thing, it's going to have a huge impact of what the next part of this is about. So what we're likely to see is, and when I gave the first talk about this, a number of people in the audience looked at their watches and said, no, it's over. And so the next day, the Republican Governor's Conference met, and 20 of them announced, hey, I'm not playing. And I said, oh, I didn't even speak there. For that, we must share some insight together. So the critical issue will absolutely be whether or not a group of states are up and running. And the governor and lieutenant governor will understand this. The Leave No Child Behind was one of the most popular ideas in U.S. history. By the time of the 2008 election, it was the most unpopular legislation that I've measured in years. And so the gap between we must fix our schools, move our kids along, and what turned out to be how it was implemented changed the way a country felt about that. So we are on the cusp here. If a dozen key states move ahead and it works, and remember, it works, the people I survey don't know. I mean, they're not involved. So what do they do? What do civic leaders say? What do business leaders say? What do physicians in hospitals say? Is this working in our state? If it works, the mood will be we will never go back in this country. We're not going to limit. We're going to find a way for this to go. But if this turns out to be No Child Left Behind, exchanges are great things. They're not running. By the way, nobody's in them for that. And if I'm in them, I want out of it. Small businesses rushed in to put their employees in there, and next year they're begging you to let them out. For that, this history has not been written yet. This is where the leadership absolutely will be decided. So, briefly, there's no support in this moment for changing the structure of Medicare or Medicaid, which is all they say. And the abortion side, here's another issue of where America just is polarized. So in the president's voters, 80% most legal, and on Governor Romney's voters, 57% want it mostly illegal. So these are there. Let's take a look at the fund of fiscal cliff for this. So turns out the core president voters think that you can solve the fiscal cliff without going much near healthcare education. They're going to prove to be wrong, but if you are a legislator thinking about running 2 years from now, and they are your voters, you are going to have a tough time. Because at the grassroots level, they just think there has to be a way to deal with this issue without saying that Medicare is going to be dramatically smaller, or Medicaid is going to be dramatically smaller, or there won't be Pell Grants anymore. They are not going to see that. On the other side, Speaker Boehner's voters feel very strongly, we have to bite a bullet and we have to make decisions here. So ultimately, we're going to have a compromise. Now, compromise is going to affect everybody in this room, but it's going to be very polarizing because people will come to the table with a different view. So I'll answer the question you would. The one who doesn't have to worry about what I'm talking about is the fellow who is elected and won't run again. So Obama has the most flexibility of anybody sitting around the table. He only can say, Bob, I'm interested in who voted for me, but I'm not going to go back to them again. He doesn't need them the way people in the legislature will. We asked people who were voting, how about large future cuts in Medicare and Medicaid? And so the thing, if you're in the politics of this, is the most bipartisan thing from a voter point of view is people are very reluctant to go near really big cuts in Medicare. So I'll just give you a hint. In things that are very unpopular, everything that deals with Medicare is like making people eat spinach. For that, the two that are least unpopular, please don't quote me as he says it's popular, is moving the retirement age. And Nancy Pelosi would be quite angry if I was here, because she doesn't think it's popular at all, but it's more tolerable. And asking anybody upper income to pay more. So where we have a consensus in this country is ask upper income people to pay more. I know you'll never have me back today after that comment, but that plays better. On the political side, Medicaid is a popular program. It's widely extensive, but it does not have the same political salience as Medicare does in our world. If you'll notice, Republican voters could easily see the subsidies for the Affordable Care Act disappear. So if I was in the House or a governor and some of them disappeared, my team will not be bothered by it. The president's team will be angrier, bitter, as it can be. What else? Well, on the president's side, nobody wants big cuts in the rest of health, the NIH, CDC. But the last point is where the debate will really go. There is an underlying division in this country about the future of defense spending. And so when we look at if they're going to go with the issue of sequestration, and please, I have to be honest with people because I've interviewed people, I've done focus groups. Sequestration among voters is a horse that they think didn't win the last race. They have no idea. What do you think about sequestration? Should we move ahead with the agreements that was made on the sequestration? Huh? I don't know. Was in the race? What? Where is it? And how about the cut? What cuts? And so we ran an election where actually most politicians would not mention the word 2013. So there was very little discussion what is in that agreement. And even now, everybody wants an agreement, but it's not at all clear to people what's in that agreement. So there will be huge ramifications, whatever is signed for there. People ask me just basically, do I think we will go over the fiscal cliff? Recall you had the end of January before this happens. I believe the answer will be no. There'll be some agreement for this, but in politics, you have the ability of kicking things into the future. So I'm the only one who always talks to political figures and they say, Bob, this is a loser. Either way, I cut, I do this, I raise taxes. And they say to me, I'm going to push the decision into the future. And my other colleagues say, take their job away from them. And Bob says, I perfectly understand. That could be somebody else's problem for that. So we are going to push some of these debate issues forward. And briefly, how do we deal with some of these issues? So to no surprise, the president knows that with his voters, raising upper income is quite fine. Taxing companies is fine with his group, but not the other team. But let me give you a secret of American politics, and my apologies to the governor, lieutenant governor, if it's not what they say. The people I survey are unbelievably in favor of taxing everybody but themselves. They are just incredibly enthusiastic about the need to raise revenues from other people for that. So this is the secret of American politics, raise revenues from other people for that. And so this is the dilemma that we are going to face. I'm not going to go through speculations. I'm going to ask people to ask me about particular issues. But I want to go back to Connecticut here a second. The Massachusetts bill got off the ground because an incredible range of civic leadership made a commitment to be involved with this. There also was an incredible amount of compromise. There were moments that the business community was going to walk away from that table over and over again for that. And people on the other side, deeply caring about advocacy side, was hoping the business community would walk away from the table. But at the end of the day, people really stayed around in trying to make the operational agreements go. Secondly, a large number of people who have to be involved in implementing this watch this like a television show. They know something's going on. They don't have any understanding of it. So the secret is having to put a lot of time in the talking to groups about how it actually would work in your real life. This involves huge changes, enrollment, employees, choices. What do I do if I work in four jobs over the week, over the year, if I'm an small employer, but I go from 50 to X number of employees, how does this work? And in the absence of understanding, people start to really get very upset and angry and say, stop the train. So whether or not Connecticut actually goes to the next phase has a lot to do with civic leadership here. It really, absolutely, it cannot happen. I could pass Medicare, and with about 18 people, I could explain it, we can get up and running. But this is actually, in real life, is unbelievably complex, and it's complex for people who are not in healthcare, businesses, people who are at different employment side for that. So the civic leadership is absolutely the most critical thing for that to go. So that is the takeaway one of it. It will not happen if groups pay no attention or decide they're going to sit on the side and see what an exchange by itself does. Exchanges only work if the major crowd does it. And also, it only works if people at the table understand that you could turn this into the U.S. Congress by walking away from the table every time there's a difficult issue. The only way you go forward is you have to reach agreement with some respect that people don't see these issues. And that is the big lesson from my polling is much of America does not see these issues solution the same way. And if we're going to move ahead, we have to accommodate people in ways that are very difficult to do, but we will not move ahead without that. And I'll close and then we'll take questions wherever we go. Is that if Connecticut isn't up and running at 214, then it's going to be very, very difficult for other states that have a much more explosive, difficult political climate to ever envision that they will play. So I don't think it'll bother it. One very prominent politician in the South, the introductions, when they ask you down to speak, but they want to make clear before they introduce you that they hate the bill. So this professor is going to talk about what's going on in America, long as you understand that we hate this bill. How do you feel, professor, about this bill? And the fellow turned to me and he said, you know, I think Massachusetts should be attached to Nova Scotia. And I said, it's funny where I come from, they think Texas should be given back to Mexico. So we are in a very difficult point of view. The president's mandate is real, but it has limits because other people in public life are from that. Let's open that, and I can speculate about where we will go in different directions. The purpose is to help people think a little bit more about the environment that they will face, and the battle over Medicaid is a perfect example. You will need those funds to do some of the things that are being discussed in this state. And out of all these discussions, part of those funds could disappear.
Questions?
Yes.
Dr. Blunden, thank you very much for your insightful comments. You mentioned sequestration, you mentioned the fiscal cliff, but you did not mention the sustainable growth rate, the SGR, for Medicare. For the past 10 years, physicians in particular have been looking at very substantial cuts in the reimbursements under the Medicare program. If those goes through, there could be very serious implications in terms of access to care. What do you think is going to happen in January 1st, 2013 with the SGR cuts and what Congress may or may not do, given the fact that if that does go through, that could represent close to a 30% reduction?
So, this is speculation. My view is that they will give physicians back part of the money. They will make large sounds that they should solve this and completely give it back. But the revenue picture to fix this problem is going to be very hard to do. So my view is if I was in the medical community, I would expect they're not going to have a 30% cut, but it will not go back to the parity of what you expected. Likewise, I don't see them having the ability to solve this problem forever. Let's fix this over two decades, principally because raising the money is going to be very, very hard. So there's no such thing as a 30% cut. They cannot live with that, the anger from seniors. But my view is there will be some erosion in what that will be. The issue will continue to reappear. It will be very frustrating for the medical community, but unless the fiscal picture gets better, it will be very hard for Congress to find the funds to do this. The Affordable Care Act is filled with a number of assumptions of where revenues and everything will come from. And it's very possible with just a small shift, the picture won't be that good and they really will be stressed to do whatever they want to do. So my bottom line is that cut will not stay, but what is in its place will not fully replace what you would have expected. That's sort of a look from a distance.
Gene Sheehan, Hi. Sullivan and Lachain, Public Relations. Doctor, was one of the things that seems to me to be critical for Connecticut to confront as we move forward is what were the issues that were at the forefront in Massachusetts that had to be confronted and resolved for it your healthcare reform to move forward?
Well, first is, and you're suffering for this, the legislature could not agree on minimum benefits. And so they turned it over to a commission for that. That made it politically possible to pass the legislation. What was important is there was a huge amount of negotiation and a great deal of tension about what the minimal benefits. Our perfect example will be, to my surprise, a large number of so-called employer-based plans in Massachusetts offer no pharmaceutical coverage. So the obvious thing for everyone concerned with these issues, let's require first-year comprehensive benefits. For companies that were involved, this is really a serious issue. They reached a compromise. Many companies are there. So the benefit issues were very much there. There are concerns about creating a situation where businesses drop coverage was on people's minds, and every compromise that could be made that remained attractive for employers to keep coverage were on absolutely people's minds. The critical background for Massachusetts is to understand that the first bill that was passed when Mike Dukakis was governor was repealed. And there was on everybody's side, from labor and business and the advocacy groups, a reality that liberal Massachusetts had once taken a bill and just repealed it, and that they had to reach agreement. So they did not rush in. Everybody lectured that they had to deal with cost containment in the hospitals and physicians right away. You could not have this bill unless you did cost containment. The position of the legislature and the governor at the time was we would encourage more competition, but we were not going to face the cost issues. So the Massachusetts now has a new cost bill, and people disagree where it is. I happen to think it's significant. It's significant that it's going to change the culture. You are aware that leadership groups are going to push. That bill came 6 years after the first bill. And so the biggest decision was legislators sat there and the governor said, we need all this regulation, we need budgets, we need control, we need reporting. And the decision was made is politically they couldn't sustain it at that time. They could not have a debate about coverage and that. So they made a decision to push that off. What are the plans that are offered? How big a gradient there are? What's in them? Who can play? Now, the Massachusetts law basically limited the number of insurers who can play. Most other states will not do that. And so under what ground rules and everything they play are really big issues. The critical thing is that this stuff was negotiated. There was a great deal of back and forth. And on the benefit issues, I was called into one, and there were religious groups arguing that we had to have the most comprehensive every time, which I would on the other side. So somebody said, well, help mediate. Well, one member there started praying and saying to me that if you knew what was justice, that you would do something. And I said, wow, this is not going to be a pleasant day here. How much is in a benefit package shouldn't be part of the religious experience. But it was. But people kept sitting at the table and saying, okay, we disagree on the benefit package. And when the requirements go into effect for this, and also there was a huge effort to make the machinery individual business friendly for small business. Those of us familiar with large corporations, you have these big human resources staff. I attended meetings, you know, with people where the spouse of the owner does all this stuff. And so they kept saying, I don't know how to deal with this. What is that? They tried very hard to have an interface that you could really easily use. And these are very important issues, because if it started to break down for everybody, the call would be to postpone. That's the Massachusetts history. You would never appeal, postpone it. Let's put it off for 2 more years. Let's put it off for 2 more years. So they really worked on the implementation side for that. And at the end of the day, people were willing to compromise. And these are not easy. Why wouldn't you want the best drug benefit for every single employee? But then you start out with people who never offered it in the cost side, and they found middle ground. So these are some of the issues that you really have to wrestle with. And also, they had huge campaigns to explain this bill to people around the state. This was not a health insider bill where your 50 closest friends know what's in this thing, but nobody else did. So they enrolled people at the Red Sox games, those of you who saw that. And the Red Sox owner said, look, this is important. We will play. And so in between the breaks, you would see they had sign up for it. So it wasn't confrontational. The discussions, we're going to fine you and penalties and everything else, was much more, let's get people signed up, let's have campaigns, let's explain why it's important. And that was all civic leadership. It did not occur just from the people who worked for the state government. It was really a commitment by civic leadership to work their way through this issue.
Well, I had a similar question. I was going to ask you a simple question. Did you think the Massachusetts health plan worked or could work? And you sort of answered it.
The answer is, it is by far the most complex way to get everybody covered. So, I mean, if you were sitting around the table and said you valued simplicity, you just wouldn't do it this way. I'm not arguing where I would do it. It just is. But given they did that, it could only work by a great deal of real civic leadership, and there were church groups and business side to figure out the complexities, because if it starts breaking down, it really is a difficult. And they integrated the enrollment from Medicaid and Commonwealth health care so people could get enrolled through the same process. You didn't have 14 different enrollment for that. And there was just a recognition it has to work at the individual, small business, and human being level, or these things fall apart. But it took a huge amount of effort. It was not obvious. If I was buying stock, I would have picked another company than the Massachusetts Exchange, personally. But a lot of people, leadership-wise, made that thing work, and it could actually work here. But it requires a great deal of leadership to think through the practical issues so it doesn't start falling down for people.
At the center of all this is a patient or a consumer. Have you done any surveying to find out or get any knowledge about when will the consumer and what will be the tipping point to take this into their own hands and start demanding cost and quality differently than today?
So these get to be very political issues. We have done most, including with the Boston Globe and a number of times, most of the statewide surveys. The consumer wanted state action on cost containment, but as I was quite honest to report, they didn't know what that meant. So for some people, it's more competition. For other, they want the governor to have the biggest club dealing with this. I am a person that has great respect for markets, but I make people nervous because I have a finding, and that is that consumers are less in love with large deductibles than you think they are. And so when people say take into their hands, I thought it's wrestling a doctor to a floor, and I think that might be popular. But they really mean very large payments out of pocket, and that is not a winner as a choice. And that's one of the reasons, if we have to go that way, this is the, you know, you push, you go that way, that we may see many more closed networks. For instance, people who say to me, I don't want to be restrictions or anything else, and I don't want high deductible plans. And if there was a high deductible plan, there's a share of people who would go to a much more closed HMO, so they don't pay the deductibles. So, but the many so-called consumers could easily turn to the politicians and say, have some government regulation for that. So if we're going to do this more through the marketplace, we need examples that marketplace things can work and in a way that people are not at risk. But again, since you have me here and you have to put up with me, let me just give you a bottom line. When it comes to illnesses, whether or not you're a senior on Medicare or someone else, they actually are very risk averse about change. They're very nervous about change. And so change has to be incremental to work. And many people scare the heck out of the people I survey. And it can be government takeover at the other side, use deductibles. People are very nervous about changes. So you want to move them incrementally in directions. But the most of the responsibility is going to end up on plans to have ways that doctors and hospitals behave differently. And yes, they'll choose some among plans, but people are not going to be terrific individual doctor, hospital consumers, unless there's a lot of incentives to do this. I have studied huge experiments of giving information to consumers to choose among surgeons and this and that. And I'm telling you, it's not a big hit. The number of people who say hospital, bad, 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 and choose it is really quite humbling. For that, with an answer is my mom went there, my grandmother went there, it's the closest, I was born there, everything else. So if we want to move people to other places, we have to have real incentives for them to shift, but we need incentives very much in the provider community. The consumer side is harder to move, and again, my apologies because many people in the audience are big believers, they're harder to move than you think they are, and you have to do other things, and that's where the innovation in the plans will be to make it more positive for people to move in other directions and save money.
Take one more. Are we over
there,
guys? Go ahead.
Hi. We used to do surveys of people's willingness to pay, which has to be, of course, well-informed as to where they're paying, how they're benefiting. For instance, the cities are getting killed with, speaking here for Hartford, of local taxes and so on. Healthcare, which is a big piece, and education and so on. How, when you do a survey, can you adequately inform folks who can then influence their legislators, state and local, of what kind of benefits they'll get if they're willing to pay a certain amount in taxes? What kind of decreases in copays, deductibles, their grandmother will be covered, their handicapped nephew. How can you convey that when you try to get a sense of what they will and will not support?
What's important is that people's views and agendas are shaped by leadership groups who go out and do this. They're not all surveys measure where you are, and so it's up to public leadership to explain what the trade-offs are. I'm quite convinced that people will go very far not to have the Medicare plan cut back on benefits for people. For that. The issue of public finance, unfortunately, is very hard for average people to understand. They don't understand the federal budget. So I can tell one war story. We're involved with many years with a project with the Washington Post, and we wanted to know what people understood about the federal budget, so we did focus groups together, and we had a group of about 20 people around, and we asked simple things, what's the big things in the budget and the small things, and so five of the people said foreign aid is half the budget, and I said, you know, it's not exactly true. So one of the editors of the Washington Post picked up the budget, and he said, right in here is a fact. It's 2-3% of the budget. Fact, 2-3%, here it is. And the people turned to him and said, you're a liar. So there's a lot, it takes a long time from public leadership to explain this. But as long as there's more money, We didn't have to do this. Now we really have to work very, very hard for people to understand, and it's public leadership. You have to talk to groups, and you have to simply show them where it is, what it is, but people are not aware of that. And as a result, they're not gonna leap on the paying more taxes unless they see a direct relationship between that and something they care about. And it's too far removed from them for it. But I'm a big believer in public leadership. You bring people along, but it's hard. People are not aware of a lot of the things that those of us here work with every day, how it works in their own lives. And if you're in public life, this screaming and yelling that I want better police services, more health services, more fire, and I want my taxes lowered is a bit humbling for this. You can have basically better services in a lot of these areas without paying more. But this has really got to be tough. Those of you involved in schools know exactly what these battles are about. But public leadership is really what about here.